Hachette Audio presents Smoke and Mirrors, How Hype Obscures the Future and How to See Past It, written and read by Gemma Milne. Introduction. It started with ghosts in the 1700s, conjured ghosts. A box would hide the projector, beaming a spooky image at an angled mirror inside, and the ghoulish form would emerge from the hole cut in the top of the box to light up the plume of smoke generated on stage, to the horror of the audience apprehensively looking on. Magicians would use the trick to delight audiences, charlatans would use it to con, but soon the smoke and mirror technique would become a classic in the magic toolbox, known as the original clever way of creating illusions. Nowadays, most magicians are known as entertainers, not witches and wizards. The audience walk into those theatres ready to suspend their disbelief in the pursuit of wonder and fun. Maybe one person wants to sit back and be wowed. Maybe another wants to play detective to spot the sleight of hand. But either way, they know and accept that the magician on stage will be on a mission to fool. And the magicians are masters of the craft of fooling. There are the physical props with hidden parts inside, but there's also their deep knowledge of how to create a trick in the mind of the audience. Magicians know exactly how to shift someone's thought process onto their desired path, to make someone believe something impossible, to misdirect. Without a degree of psychological manipulation, there is no magic trick. Of course, magicians are honest deceivers. There's a reason that David Devon, the first president of the famous magic circle, is remembered for his catchphrase, "All done with kindness." And, of course, non-consensual fooling, or lying as it's more commonly known, is almost never a truly kind act. But what does it mean to be accidentally fooled, to be swept up in tantalising ideas or trusted opinions or simple hope that something false is true? To be tricked somewhat, not out of malice from a magician of sorts behind the scenes, but by simplified narrative, distracted focus, or an unchecked desire for something to be true cloaking rational thought. This powerful tool capable of misleading is hype. And it's powerful because it's not always a tool that someone somewhere has chosen to wield, but because it can so easily be misconstrued, carelessly used, and spread like wildfire. There are many stories of lying, deception, and misuse of power, but I'd argue that hype can be even more damaging than deliberate, sometimes criminal, actions. Conspiracies, too, make for intriguing reading, but the curious power of hype is one that, in my mind, makes for an under-discussed truth much stranger and more compelling than speculation. Before we go on, we should probably define hype. Some describe it as extravagant or intensive promotion. Others define it as the use of a lot of advertising to make people interested in something. Others go for, simply, exaggerated publicity. Whatever specific words you go for, it's clear that when we use hype to describe sentiment, it is somewhat biased towards a particular perception, not because of the facts about its merit, but because of the particular words and narratives surrounding it. Sometimes those words and narratives are warranted, sometimes they are not. Sometimes hype perfectly encapsulates the future being built, sometimes it obscures it. Sometimes it results in socially beneficial over-embellishment, sometimes it changes the course of progress for the worse. The crucial thing then is not to halt all hype or banish its use across the board, but instead to understand when we are presented with hype and how to sort the fair from the problematic. Hype, like any tool, isn't inherently good or bad. It can be the tool with which we gather communities around positive societal change, and it can be the tool that misleads to satisfy the ill-conceived wants of a few immoral actors. Sometimes people don't even know they're propagating it, but when hype starts to grow unchecked, it doesn't really matter who started it and why. What matters is that it's spotted before any damage happens. Unfortunately, and in some cases tragically, this can be far easier said than done. Those who work in science and technology are often tasked with and driven by making the world a better place, and understandably so. Their work is mostly comprised of progressing onwards from one state of knowledge to the next, and then applying this new knowledge to the world around them. It's broadly an ambitious activity, fueled by optimism, tenacity, and unwillingness to settle for an unsatisfactory result when more can still be done. It's also a complex area, both in terms of depth of understanding of those at the coalface, as well as keeping up with the pace of discovery and invention. And in trying to work out exactly what's happening in science and technology, you can often be confronted with a lack of understandable information, an abundance of oversimplified generalisation, and indecipherable ambiguity. It's in these conditions that hype tends to be wielded as a tool to aid communication and comprehension, but they're also the conditions that make hype ripe for unhinged propagation. Beating hype individually can be as simple as spotting it, as its power is in its illusion. But if we're to avoid consequences that affect society at large, spotting and contextualising hype must be done collectively by the masses to stop it in its tracks. My hope with this book is to show you that anyone, regardless of scientific background and confidence, can learn to see past hype. We can't get it right every time, but surely with more people even just stopping to consider whether something they hear, see or read is hype, our collective societal intelligence massively increases. I'm a science and technology writer, so it's my job to meet incredible inventors, thinkers and entrepreneurs and tell their stories to the world. It's also my job to make sure I'm writing thoughtfully, carefully and ethically, knowing that my words can have power in raising people and companies up or curbing problematic actors. I also work with a venture capital fund, helping them find promising young startups, and I advise government on which company missions merit public money and public hope. My job means trying to get to the bottom of what's going on in industries, who is legitimate, and what the future potential looks like through many different lenses, financial, societal, and more. I'm paid to think critically. Before I became a writer, I worked in advertising, where I learned the power of messaging both for good and not for good. I watched big companies pick a narrative that fitted the zeitgeist, regardless of how authentic it was for the reality of their company, and sway consumers towards their stories and their stores. I also worked in corporate innovation and advertising, where my job was to travel the world to work out what the latest trends in technology and startups were for the agency's clients, and I learned that innovation can regularly be a hype-driven marketing tool, much more so than a mindset or a research and development strategy. In short, hype has played a huge role in my career, in finding the best ways to create it, in spotting it, in writing about it, and in striving to beat it. I've seen hype do amazing things, frustrate the hell out of me, and horrify me when I can clearly see the dangerous behaviour it can inspire. I'm by no means perfect in spotting and beating hype. No one is, as we'll discover throughout this book. But I'm fortunate in that many of my jobs have had some element of hype attached to them, and the diversity of jobs I've done, we didn't even touch on the brief investment banking foray, the summer camp chef, the door-to-door salesperson or the wedding waitress, means that I tend to look at things through various lenses automatically. I'm a jack of many trades, master of not getting stuck in a silo, as it were. I've chosen 9 areas of science and technology through which to tell this story of hype. These specific areas are of interest because they are the moonshots of our time, and thus they carry many different forms of hype within them. Some are regularly talked about in the popular media, some are only emerging out of the more insular science and technology world, others are beneath the surface. I've picked them as they all represent a different kind of hype, and each story of hype results in different impacts on the world. They are all very legitimate areas of science and technology. I've broadly stayed away from hype around pseudoscience and stuck to misguided hype around reality. I believe we should all, as citizens of the world, have a firmer grip on the areas covered in this book, regardless of our scientific background. Science and technology are part of society, after all, and being swept up in hype in these crucial areas means, as we'll discover, potentially very problematic effects on our planet and on people. This book is split into 3 parts. Now, next, and nearing. Within each part are 3 areas of science and technology relevant to that time frame, the role that hype plays within them, the existing and possible future repercussions of that hype, and an exploration of how we might spot and contextualise that hype moving forward. Each role of hype and each method of spotting it can arguably be applied across many chapters and indeed other areas of science and technology this book doesn't include. The point is not to just take my word as gospel in these specific realms, but to show you how we can all go about seeking out the patterns that hype exhibits and the tactics we can employ beyond these pages. In the first part, now, we'll see the current impact that hype has on our world and how it helps retain a problematic status quo, how it can be a double-edged sword, and how it can shield complexity. In next, we'll see how hype is currently swaying the development of crucial fields and how it can curb action, how it can shield flaws, and how it can act just like a placebo of sorts, telling us one thing but fueling another. Finally, in nearing, we'll explore how hype affects us as individuals and ultimately damages future progress in its fanatical nature, in its relinquishing of responsibility, and its halting of the most crucial activity of them all, critical thinking. Throughout, we'll explore that which blinkers us from seeing past hype, such as marketing, perceived expertise, complexity, fear of being wrong, bad incentives, human psychology, and idealism. We'll see both why they blinker us so easily and what can be done to remove them as hurdles. Spotting and contextualising hype isn't about learning the nitty-gritty of how science and technology work, but rather seeing how they fit into the systems of society and looking at ideas through various different perspectives, such as media, financial markets, law, geopolitics, socioeconomics, and the environment. No science and technology book is complete without a little intertwining of how the world actually works. We'll also discuss those uncomfortable truths about our more active susceptibility to hype, our reluctance to change, and our dissociation of various kinds of responsibility. Hype tends to only rear its ugly head when the majority don't know that it's hype, when we don't collectively realise that we're consuming amped-up ideas as opposed to those celebrated on merit. And without being able to tell one from the other, what chance do we have, actually, to engage with science and technology, to consider whether we agree with the celebration of merit or not, to vote for a better future with our behaviour and our ballot papers, armed with more, better information? Hype is an effective tool, there's no doubt about that, but if we want to wield its power responsibly or simply curb its potentially harmful effects, we must first work out how the sleight of hand is done. And would you believe, I have the book of magic tricks right here. Part 1. Now. Feeding the world. Finding the true meaning of value in the world of farming. Have you ever considered how strangely common bananas are? If, like me, you live in Europe, the US, or some parts of Asia, you'll know that bananas aren't grown anywhere close to where we live, and yet they are a staple part of most of our diets. They are the first thing we see when we walk into a supermarket, showing the store off to be the perfect picture of health, freshness, and abundance. They go into our lunchboxes and our healthy shakes and our baked loaves. We debate as to whether they brown faster in the fridge or on the countertop. Some people are freaked out by the stringy bits. Some people prefer them more ripe. Some people can't get their heads around why everyone else likes bananas so much. Bananas are cheap and easy, and we love them for it. There's a hidden cost behind bananas, though. In fact, there are several. From low wages, low income, and lack of social security for those who work on and own small banana plantations, to high environmental costs, including huge land occupation, overuse of fertilisers and water depletion, the true cost of bananas is not at all reflected in the price we pay at the supermarket. The true cost of bananas is felt in the effects of agriculture on our planet, our health, and the widening of the wealth gap. The price is paid, but not in the supermarket. It's not just bananas, of course. Much of the food we see on supermarket shelves is priced as low as possible to drive consumers into stores. Some fruit and veg we buy is actually priced lower than what the supermarket paid for it, just to encourage us to choose one shop over the other. They are the so-called loss leaders. Think of the supermarket adverts leading with their competitive prices for the basics, a bunch of bananas for only 90p, prompting us to choose that shop for our full weekly food purchase at the expense of a small loss over a common fruit. Cheap food isn't just about getting customers into supermarkets. It's not just a cynical corporate move. We, the public, demand low prices, and when prices go up, we see it as a sign of our government's failing. Changing prices can quickly become political. In Britain, we spend only 9% of our total household outgoings on our food shopping. After the US and Singapore, Britain comes third in the race to the bottom of spending on food. We also spend less than our parents and our grandparents did, with the proportion of our income dedicated to food more than halving since the 1950s. Despite our relatively cheap food, though, we balk at the idea of food prices going up, no matter the rationale. In 2018, a UK summer heatwave reduced feed for dairy cattle, hugely impacting dairy farmers, and the price of milk subsequently went up. Newspapers widely covered the understandable rise in price, with The Express describing it as soaring, and presented the general public as the party to lose out, the Metro writing, "Shoppers could be facing paying as much as 7.5% more for a pint of milk." In 2016, the reduced value of the British pound following the Brexit vote resulted in Unilever increasing their wholesale price of the UK's beloved, by some, Marmite. This then caused Tesco to refuse to stock it and prompted the court of public opinion to brand the trade dispute Marmite Gate. When these price changes happen due to global market and environmental effects, we tend not to consider how cheaper food really is with respect to how it gets from the farm to our plate, and instead point the finger at the broken agriculture system, the government, or greedy companies. Artificially low food prices ironically have some of the biggest negative repercussions for those at the lower end of the socioeconomic scale, The lowest prices are mostly preserved for the unhealthiest food. The cheapest calories tend to be the least healthy. Responsibility for the low price of food and high costs hidden behind the scenes doesn't sit with one player alone, but the party that arguably has one of the biggest influences in the way our food is priced, and thus how farming is done, is the one we regularly emit in our complaints toward the food industry. It's also the one we find hardest to face, ourselves. Price versus cost. The seemingly darker stories of what goes on behind our food do make headlines. There are plenty of, well actually, type articles telling vegans that opting for cashew milk is causing farm workers to be exposed to dangerous toxic materials when often not provided with gloves. Or there are the ones telling millennials that their avocado obsession is fueling murderous Mexican drug cartels over the green gold growing in the Michoacán region. There's also been increasing coverage of the climate effects that farming, specifically dairy and meat farming, has on the planet, prompting much petitioning and public discussion about the benefits of vegan diets. Of course, these stories aren't just inflammatory clickbait, as there are human rights violations that happen the world over in industries that ultimately make a lot of money. Agriculture is not so different from the diamond trade, the electronics industry, and the fast fashion manufacturers in that regard. And for people of certain cultures, socioeconomic classes, and personal situations, veganism, or a refusal to buy certain foods from certain shops, makes sense with respect to individual values and health choices. For many, veganism is considered the only logical choice given the industrialization of the meat and dairy industry. But the food system is not just a machine in need of an upgrade. There are even bigger problems in the food industry, and they are far more nuanced than a consumer boycott can solve. The evidence that the food industry is contributing to negative societal, environmental, and health impacts is piling up, and the reasons for these huge hidden costs are often left in research papers and out of the public consciousness, and thus are not at all factored into the price we pay for food. The lack of understanding of the real inherent issues of the agricultural system also leads to naive optimism in the approaches to solving problems. There's the idealistic view that we should all go back to the glory days of farming before it became industrialized, but that doesn't solve the problem of meeting demand. There is also a modern idealism that's crept in, where there are huge efforts to use innovations in science and technology to make agriculture more sustainable, more productive, cheaper, and more on demand. This modern idealism is leading many to believe the hype that technology will save us. These efforts are useful to some extent, but they are band-aids on a gaping wound. If we avoid buying some foods for environmental reasons without knowing if there will be poverty-inducing repercussions for farmers at the coalface, it only solves one problem of the food system and exacerbates another. Similarly, we cannot invent our way out of our food system's failings. The system is far too complex and interdependent on social, environmental, and economic issues for a series of high-tech band-aids. Going vegan, eating less beef, and buying from a local farmer's market are all positive actions, which many are understandably increasingly moving towards. And innovative technologies and scientific discoveries can go some way to solving some pieces of the agricultural puzzle. But without a shift in broader economic values and an understanding that the price and real cost of some foods simply don't add up, individual and entrepreneurial purpose-driven actions run the risk of simply scratching the surface. The food system doesn't need fixing. It needs redesign. It needs to be a system not fueled by reduction in price, but by ensuring a sustainable, fair, healthy world. Individual and entrepreneurial efforts are great at tackling specific issues, and they are the seeds of the shift in consumer values required for a new way of doing things. But we cannot give in to the hype that these are the only efforts required. A more fundamental change is necessary, and if we believe that tech and boycotts are all that's needed, we'll miss the opportunities for change when they present themselves. In order to spot these opportunities, though, we need to understand the scale and range of the problems in the agriculture industry and work out how to carefully, quickly, and without causing more damage, rebuild this well-oiled but highly problematic agri-industrial machine with environmental and ethical concerns at its heart. It can't carry on like this. When sustainability of agriculture is discussed, often greenhouse emissions are the main topic of conversation. Understandably so, considering the fact that the agriculture industry only tails the transport and electricity generation industries in its total emissions produced. Of those emissions, cows are responsible for two-thirds due to the methane that they produce. Sustainable farming means more than farming that doesn't create so many emissions. It means farming that doesn't deplete all our natural resources and that can be maintained as society continues to develop. And this is where the bigger problems start to arise. For example, agriculture is responsible for 70% of all global freshwater withdrawals, reducing the availability of clean water for other industries and uses. As the world warms with climate change, water also becomes more scarce. The agriculture industry not only uses most of the water, but the fertilisers and pesticides used in farming pollute the water in the surrounding area, having an even greater effect on clean water provision. It's a particular combination of the chemical use and certain farming practices that leads to water contamination, and although there are farming techniques that keep the chemicals in the soil, they are more expensive and intensive and therefore less common. It's also worth pointing out that in some developing countries where there are no formal resources to aid farmers, there's little in the way of education for farmers to learn more sustainable practices. Also, land use in agriculture is hugely problematic. Not only does farming take up around half of available livable land, expansion of farms results in deforestation and destruction of precious animal ecosystems. The land we farm on is also inefficient, with 77% of farmland used for livestock, which supplies society with only 17% of our calories. It's not just water and land that are needed to grow or nourish our food sources. Plants, animals, and microorganisms act as natural support systems. There are the bees, insects, bats, and birds that pollinate 3/4 of the world's crops but are drastically declining, some threatened with extinction. There's the fact that our soil is becoming less productive due to its biodiversity being reduced drastically by pesticides, fertilizers, and climate change. There's the severe reduction in diversity of plant species as we home in on plants that are cheaper and easier to farm. 60% of the world's total crop production is only 4 species, maize, rice, wheat, and soya, while the vast majority of the 7,000 plants we are able to grow for produce are in steep decline. There's the loss of green spaces to make way for concrete cities and roads, and the agriculture industry itself is to blame too, with its expansion into wild land leaving less room for living things to thrive. Food demand is also growing, not only due to population growth, but also urbanisation, global income growth, and changing consumer choices. And it's not just about more food, but about fresher, healthier, trendier food too. All this means that by 2050, if we stick with our current agricultural systems and processes, we'll need 65% more water and 67% more land, and we'll produce 87% more greenhouse gases in our bid to satisfy both the hunger and demand for choice of the estimated 10 billion people that will be living on Earth. When we say that farming today is not sustainable, we don't just mean that the industry contributes to global warming. We mean that we simply don't have enough resources on Earth to satisfy future demand. We cannot go on like this. Our food system is killing us. Out of the 7 billion people who live on Earth now, 3 billion are plagued by malnutrition. The number is so high because malnutrition doesn't just refer to those who are hungry from lack of food, it also refers to those who are obese and those who are deficient in micronutrients due to poor diet. With increases in cheap, highly processed food, obesity and micronutrient deficiency are prevalent worldwide. Climate change and conflict hugely impact food security across nations, particularly in the developing world. Nutrition is so bad, it was found that poor diets were responsible for 11 million deaths worldwide in 2017. Tobacco, on the other hand, causes about 7 million deaths annually. Malnutrition leads to increases in cancer, heart disease, diabetes, and all sorts of other chronic illnesses, thus adding to the burden on national healthcare systems. There are 800 million people worldwide who live in hunger. That's a hard number to accept, considering a third of food produced for human consumption is wasted each year. That's enough to feed 2 billion people. In developing countries, this waste is usually down to poor logistics and transport infrastructure, a frustrating answer to the question of why people are starving. Good nutrition is required to grow economies, and yet many efforts that focus on solving the world's nutrition problems sit firmly in the charitable sector. Companies donate to malnutrition mitigating efforts, but little is being done outside of the corporate social responsibility departments. The World Food Programme, set up to fight hunger worldwide, has a budget made up of governmental aid funds, corporate giving programmes, and individual donors. If companies and governments continue to see tackling nutrition as a charitable effort, as opposed to an economic one, thus underfunding and undervaluing solutions, The malnutrition problem worldwide will continue to be too big to solve, will continue to kill people, and will continue to reduce the prosperity of nations. And of those 800 million people who suffer from hunger worldwide, 3/4 of them are farmers. It's a vicious irony that those who produce food have a lack of it to eat themselves. Suicide is also rife within the farming profession. As climate change continues to cause unexpected adverse weather events worldwide, causing unpredictable and uncontrollable crop yield or destroying harvest altogether, farmers' income is reduced to the point that they are going hungry or, in some cases, taking their own lives. In the US, the farmer suicide rate is almost double the national average. One farmer every 4 days takes their own life in Australia. In France, it's every 2 days. Farmers kill themselves in China to protest against urbanisation. India reports over 17,000 farmer suicides every year. The instability of income for farmers is often found to be related to the self-inflicted deaths. An unusually wet winter in Ireland in 2012 led to both trouble growing hay for feed as well as an increase in the suicide rate. The farmer suicide rate went up 10 times in the UK during the 2001 foot and mouth disease outbreak, during which the government required farmers to slaughter their animals. Our food system is killing us. Not only is it killing us through the prevalence and cheapness of unhealthy food, it's killing those of us who grow the food by propagating the environmental issues causing fatal uncertainty and stress. The cost of low-priced food to the poor. When the food industry is proven to be unsustainable and detrimental to human health worldwide, the hidden costs of food start to emerge. To some, the answer is to raise the price of food, to shift incentives within the industry towards producing better food, altering practices to be more environmentally friendly, and paying farmers more. Of course, the answer cannot be so simple, especially given that wealth distribution is becoming more polarised, yet everyone's got to eat. In the UK, the richest 10% spend about £90 per household each week on their food shop. The poorest 10% spend less than £30, making food inequality rife in one of the wealthiest nations on earth. The price of fresh, healthy food has risen relative to the price of highly processed, unhealthy foods. In the UK, almost 1 million people live in so-called food deserts. These are places where fresh, healthy food is largely inaccessible due to poor public transport links to big supermarkets and a wealth of small corner shops or fast food outlets, both providing predominantly unhealthy processed junk food. In the US, over 23 million people live in food deserts. Pair all this with the fact that in first world countries, more than half of the food waste happens in the home, and this carefree attitude towards food, no matter the quality, is often attributed to the low prices that we find in supermarkets. But in the eyes of those in poverty, the idea that food prices are too low relative to their hidden costs could be perceived as almost insulting, and so getting access to better food for those who desperately need it, while ensuring that the whole supply chain of that better food is compensated fairly, is a difficult task. Easy-to-manufacture food, created by companies that underpay and pressurise suppliers and growers, is cheaper to buy, and the bad health outcomes as a result of that are killing the poor. Technology will save us. The issues of the current food system centre on sustainability, malnutrition, and the socio-economic divide. And as these problems have slowly been emerging in recent times, scientific and entrepreneurial efforts have been increasingly pointed towards solving these monumental global issues. The year 2018, it seems, was a breakout period for agri-food tech startups. Startups creating new innovations for farmers, manufacturers, restaurants, retailers, and consumers. A tidy $16.9 billion was invested into these new companies intent on disrupting the food system, an increase of 550% across the 6 preceding years. There is much optimism and excitement around the prospect of pointing new technologies towards optimising the traditional agriculture sector and using the power of science to grow more food at a lower societal cost. Most of the companies in the space have purpose-driven missions, and the startup founders take on the difficult task of building new enterprises in the hope of making the world a better place for all. There are many different startups focusing on many different problems. They are focused on making people more healthy, or making farming more sustainable, or making good food more accessible, or making farming more profitable for farmers. They are asking questions such as, does it get rid of the issue of weather unpredictability? Does it reduce our reliance on animals for protein? Does it increase yield for farmers? Is it nicer to the planet? Does it make the food last longer and hence reduce waste? The size of the food industry and the number of problems it presents mean there are ample opportunities for the entrepreneurial-minded to start building. The perceived potential of startups in solving the problems of the food industry has led to a lot of surrounding hype and a general feeling that we can invent our way out of the mess that is agriculture today. A note, some people might look at the food industry today and see it as anything but a mess. Farms yield more than ever, and thus more food is being produced than ever before, which for some is the system's only job. I'd argue that this viewpoint is a narrow and short-sighted one, as the food industry clearly isn't only about producing large volumes of food, and that if we continue as we are today, the system is simply unsustainable. In short, it may not be a mess in the eyes of some today, but without change, it very soon will become abundantly clear, even to those with that narrow production-focused view. Planet-friendly, animal-free protein. The effect that meat farming has on the environment gets a lot of press. For red meat in particular, there's the methane emitted by the animals, but the livestock industry in general requires a lot of land for grazing, making it the single most important driver of deforestation. There are also poorly enforced rules around managing slurry and manure, and the land, once used for livestock, is overgrazed to such an extent it cannot then be used for growing crops. On the other hand, around 1 billion people work in livestock farming, and they are overwhelmingly concentrated in developing countries. Some of the world's poorest people depend on meat and livestock to make a living. Despite the media coverage of rising veganism, global consumption of meat is growing. In high-income countries such as those in Europe, Oceania, and North America, we eat a lot of meat, but there's a relative plateau. In countries such as China, for instance, where income has been increasing for its citizens, eating meat comes with higher wages, and thus overall consumption is growing. India might be the only exception here, in terms of official data, but there seems to be evidence that more meat is being eaten there than is being reported, due to social and cultural pressures. All in all, meat eating is rising, and that, in turn, is only going to increase the environmental damage that comes with it. The numbers are worrying, and this has prompted much innovation in creating so-called alternative proteins to somehow reduce and curb society's reliance on meat. We need enough protein in our diets, and many of us are drawn to eating meat both from a nutritional and taste perspective, so simply removing meat altogether without anything to fill the gap would not only cause public outcry, but increased malnutrition in certain societies. With plant alternatives, of course, there's the option of simply eating them in their natural form, for example, eating lentils, beans, or chickpeas. Or there's the option of creating a vegetarian version of a meat classic, such as a bean burger. But for people who love to eat meat, simply removing it from their diet isn't so simple, as there's a craving for something that looks, feels, and tastes like meat. The yeast feast. Fermenting yeast is by no means a new idea. For thousands of years, we've known how to harness yeast's power to create two of the most wonderful foodstuffs, bread and alcohol. Nowadays, yeast is being harnessed for something else, plant-based meat. California-based Impossible Foods is possibly the best-known startup in the plant-based, taste-like-meat space, and using modern biotechnology techniques, it was able to discover which molecules are at the root of a burger's meaty taste and smell. It turned out this molecule was heme, an iron-carrying molecule associated with one of the key muscle proteins, myoglobin. Heme isn't just found in cow muscle, though. It's also found in lesser amounts in soy plant roots, and so the team at Impossible Foods genetically engineered yeast cells to contain the soy plant gene responsible for heme, and set about producing high quantities of this vegetarian meat-tasting molecule by fermenting the modified yeast. The heme is also responsible for binding iron, which then binds with oxygen, creating the red blood that oozes out of the Impossible Burger patty, creating an even more meaty illusion. Beyond Meat is the other big name in plant-based burgers, and instead of using soy plant protein, it chose pea protein and refuses to use any genetically modified products. For some people, avoiding soy and GMO foods is important. Instead, Beyond Meat uses biotechnological techniques essentially to match the parts of the plant that are also found in meat, extracting them, and rearranging and assembling them into a more meat-like architecture. The products are already on the market, and both companies enjoyed a lot of success in 2019 in particular, with Beyond Meat going public on the stock markets and Impossible Burgers teaming up with Burger King. Growing muscle in the lab. Making burgers from plants is one thing. Making burgers from real meat that's not from an animal is another. Cultured meat is meat that is made from muscle tissue grown in a lab. A small number of stem cells are extracted from animal muscle, and when encouraged along with a nutrient-rich serum, they grow. The meat is real meat, but opposed to growing inside the body of an animal, scientists essentially replicate that process outside the cow, pig, chicken, or whichever animal you please. And in theory, just one stem cell could be used to grow infinite amounts of meat, meaning the animals really are not required. There are many startups in this space, and many animal products being cultured. There's Memphis Meats and Mosa Meats, Finless Foods focusing on fish, Perfect Day Foods focusing on dairy products, Clara Foods focusing on eggs, the list goes on. In 2013, the first lab-grown burger was removed from its Petri dish, cooked in front of the world's press and tasted by food critics, all to prove to the world that lab-grown meat was not only doable, but safe, edible and tasty. At the time, that burger took 2 years and $330,000 to create, but since then, the costs have started to come down. Beyond cost, there's the issue of upscaling. A bioreactor is required to create the perfect conditions for the muscle cells to grow, and the largest ones out there can only create enough meat to feed 10,000 people in a year, meaning many of these would be needed to create an economical meat-growing plant. Another issue is the serum. The mixtures that are currently most successful require animal blood, meaning animals would indeed still be required until new serums have been invented. To do this, scientists need to work out exactly what is in the blood out of thousands of substances that makes it so effective in the serum, and then find ways of artificially creating that specific substance without the animal. Bugs for dinner. Snack packs of crickets and mealworms have been around for a while as a high-protein gym snack or something those into experimental food might incorporate into niche dinner parties and have been farmed as foods in many societies for thousands of years. In parts of Central Africa, up to half of the protein required for a healthy diet has historically come from insects. Nowadays, the push towards finding alternative proteins means that snack packs of freeze-dried critters are becoming more common, but overcoming the ick factor that comes with eating bugs is no mean feat in many cultures. Over the last few years, though, much research and entrepreneurial activity have gone into working out how to farm insects at scale and turn them into flours, oils, and other base ingredients instead of expecting consumers not used to eating bugs to snack on crickets as opposed to beef jerky. Insects can also be used as feed for livestock, for instance for fish and poultry farming, replacing the very unsustainable fish meal as the feed of choice. One of the big benefits of insects being farmed at this more mass market scale is that they can be farmed on feed that livestock cannot eat and would otherwise have been wasted, such as the clean byproducts of other industries such as milling and alcohol production. Farming insects also looks to be far cheaper and far kinder to the environment relative to the proteins that they can replace. Work still needs to be done in finding ways to scale insect farming, while maintaining its environmental benefits at a cost that makes it acceptable for those buying feed and base ingredients. Feed for fish farming in Europe can come in at only €1 per kilogram, whereas insect protein, without farming at scale, can cost around €100 per kilogram. In 2019, though, French company Insect raised €100 million from investors to build the biggest automated insect farm in the world in northern France. But with this farm currently focused on feed, there's still work to be done in getting insects more directly into the food we eat. How to sell alternative protein. The alternative protein market is booming, both rightly and understandably so, but it doesn't come without imperfections. Ground beef is very cheap to buy as a result of years of industrialised production, and this low price in some sense anchors expectations about what is a reasonable price to pay for the protein element of a meal. The plant-based burgers are more expensive to buy. Corn, which is the one alternative protein that has managed to reach mass market level to some degree, is still considered a niche vegetarian food many meat eaters aren't interested in buying. There's a risk that plant-based meat will have the same fate if consumer attitudes towards the price of food doesn't change. Cultured meat, then, presents an interesting opportunity to convert meat eaters to alternative protein. The science is still currently far off, though, and the price so high that even as production methods come down, it could still be out of reach as a mass market product. In 2019, there was a study that found that the CO2 emissions from electricity generation in labs creating cultured meat could be more detrimental for the environment in terms of greenhouse gases than meat farming. This was based on the fact that methane isn't as damaging to the atmosphere compared to CO2, as methane only sticks there for about 12 years, whereas CO2 accumulates for millennia. Again, though, the biggest hurdle looks to be convincing us to make the switch. Food decisions, of course, aren't just about price. For those who don't live below the poverty line and have more control over which foods are accessible to them, intrinsic beliefs, culture, personal taste, personal health, and the media narratives that surround particular foods all play a role in helping us decide what to eat. What's particularly puzzling in the alternative meat space is the idea of the authenticity or realness of food. Cultured meat, despite being the same chemical makeup as the meat from animals, can easily be mistaken for a Frankenstein-esque science experiment. Plant-based meat can still feel not real to some, and there has been controversy over the inputs in Beyond Meat in particular. In 2019, its stock dipped when a consumer group warned of chemicals in fake meat, as CNBC put it. Corn is considered not real food by many people due to the number of additives, particularly in the context of modern clean eating health trends, despite its arguably more clean effect on the environment. Balancing cleanliness with respect to health and cleanliness with respect to the planet might be a tough communication task. The push towards alternative protein is forcing us all to consider what real food actually is and what the costs and benefits are to the authentic food demand. Learning from past mistakes. Narratives that we assign and internalise aren't just based on personal choice and opinion. They are often swayed by misunderstanding, misinformation, and an unwillingness to consider the possibility that what is already believed is incorrect. And the power of misinformed narrative hasn't been more overt than in the debates around GM, genetically modified food. GM food has had genes from other species inserted to give it desirable characteristics, such as not spoiling so quickly, growing larger, or being resistant to certain diseases. There is scientific consensus that food derived from GM crops is no more of a threat to human health than non-GM food. But when these crops were introduced in the 1990s, there was much public debate and misunderstanding about whether they were safe. Despite the American Medical Association, the National Academy of Sciences, the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and the World Health Organization all taking a public stance that GM foods were safe, only slightly more than a third of US consumers believed them. Words such as frankenfish are still used to describe GM food, and this anti-GM sentiment of the general public has fed into politics, with many countries around the world almost completely banning the use of GM crops for arguably the wrong reasons. GM food has been the topic of much debate over the years, and there are certainly good and bad sides to this technology, as there are with any other, but some of the arguments against its use are rooted in misunderstanding of the science. Some GM crops contribute to the monoculture of the agriculture industry due to their need for certain pesticides. There are other issues around food companies owning the intellectual property of foods people depend on, which the biotech companies behind GM foods require. A study released in 2019, focused on the US, France, and Germany, showed that the most extreme opponents of GM food know the least about science, but believe they know the most. The lead researcher, Philip Fernbach, said in an interview with The Guardian, "If we don't know much, it's hard to assess how much you know. The feeling of understanding that they have then stops them from learning the truth." The study has parallels with a few key social psychology observations: the Dunning-Kruger effect, that those who are incompetent at something are unable to recognise their own incompetence; active information avoidance, where information that clashes with existing worldviews is avoided; and the backfire effect, the puzzling tendency of some people to become further entrenched in their own worldview after being presented with conflicting evidence. In 2018, the European Court of Justice ruled that the latest advance in GM foods, editing genes as opposed to inserting genes from other species, a much more precise process, would be subject to the same rules used for GM foods more broadly. This decision was widely criticised by the European scientific community, claiming the decision would dramatically slow innovation in European crop science. Some argued that the decision had been made based on misunderstanding and a political will to side with the misinformed public. If the alternative meat sector wants to avoid the damaging narratives that have so severely tarnished the GM food field, communication around these new foods has to feed into how people think with an understanding of what the existing narratives already are. It's also worth pointing out that meat isn't eaten just to satisfy our protein need. Many of us eat for pleasure, for health, for community. If those trying to switch people away from environmentally damaging eating habits fail to also keep this in mind, adoption of alternative meat is likely to stay niche and broadly ineffective in solving the problems of the agriculture industry. Digitising the farm. By using the power of the internet, sensors, mobile phones, communication networks, knowledge sharing, and more intelligent analysis of data, some level of control can be gained over the unpredictable, manual labour-heavy, interdependent and complicated task of growing food well. There's the technology that reduces the human labour required to run a farm, such as robotics and drones for managing crops, and the barn-mounted facial recognition cameras capturing health information about livestock without having to check each animal individually. There's the technology that gives farmers more information on what they should farm and when, such as sensors tracking the soil, satellite data providing climate insights, and online marketplaces where buyers and farmers can connect their supply and demand, just like Airbnb connects travellers and available rooms. There's even the technology that allows for entirely different farming systems altogether, such as the indoor farms and farms automated in their entirety. It is estimated that there are more than 570 million farms worldwide, and of those, around 90% are run by an individual farmer or a family and rely primarily on family labour. The vast majority of farms are small, many of which are less than 2 hectares in size, called smallholder farms. And despite these farms having little space to work with, operating on only 12% of the world's land available for agriculture, they produce 80% of the foods consumed in Asia and sub-Saharan Africa. Small and family-run farms, though, tend to be hit hardest by the things that make farming hard, such as unpredictable weather, crop disease, pests, and fluctuating market prices. They don't have big companies underwriting their efforts, as large industrial farms do, and they rely on the transfer of knowledge from generation to generation to keep the farms in business. The average age of a farmer is 60 years old, and farming is becoming less attractive as an occupation due to increasingly poor farming conditions, both economically and environmentally. Saying that, it's found that when young farmers take an active role in family farms, new technology is more readily adopted and the income of those farms indeed goes up. Many of the digital innovations in farming have the potential to revolutionise farms all over the world, making small and family-run farms easier to manage, more profitable and more efficient. But many of the initial target customers for these technologies and business models are the wealthy, technologically savvy industrial outfits, reflected in their high costs and effectiveness only at scale. And the digital innovations specifically targeted towards farmers in developing countries, where relatively simple technologies can have a huge impact, don't garner as much hype, investment and business support. The startups in this space are not so-called unicorns, so they're not creating huge sums of money in return on investment for funders. And some of the most impactful use cases are simple applications of older, arguably more boring, technology, such as weather reports sent by text. There seems to be a disconnect between what gets the most hype in the future farming space versus what is hugely impactful for the majority of the world's farmers and the people they are responsible for feeding. There's one agritech innovation that epitomises this disconnect more than most, and that is the vertical farm. The rise of vertical farming. In 2010, Dixon Despommier, an emeritus professor of microbiology and public health at Columbia University, published a book called The Vertical Farm: Feeding the World in the 21st Century. In it, he outlined a vision for the future of the agriculture industry, where food is grown in urban skyscrapers using artificial lights, heaters, water pumps, and the power of computers to grow crops indoors. He wrote about how these vertical farms would integrate food production into cities, increase the amount of produce per unit of land area, recycle the small amount of water required, protect crops from pests without needing to use pesticides, and reduce the distance food is transported to reach urban customers. His rationale behind the need for change was on point. He argued that soil is being exploited, that farming is inefficient, that the food system is broken. The problem, though, is that vertical farming doesn't solve those problems. Still, since the beginning of the century, The idea of growing food vertically in urban areas has increasingly captured the minds of architects, of engineers, of designers, of plucky entrepreneurs, and wealthy Silicon Valley investors. There are many startups out there that have created indoor systems, glowing magenta from the LEDs inside, providing optimal light for photosynthesis, with trays of greenery, line by line, stacked one on top of the other. Of course, to the cannabis dealers in high-rise buildings, the idea might not seem quite so innovative, but the technology used in these indoor systems certainly is advanced. Whether it's in the converted shipping containers of Boston startup Freight Farms or the huge warehouses of New Jersey startup AeroFarms, the advancement of hydroponics, growing plants using nutrient solutions as opposed to soil, and pairing that with intelligent computer systems monitoring and then optimising the growth, have resulted in technologically advanced ways of growing food. Technologically advanced ways, however, are not always the best ways. The downside of vertical farming. For starters, the energy requirements of vertical farms are tremendous. For every square metre of lettuce growing area, a traditionally heated greenhouse needs about 250 kilowatt hours of energy a year, whereas a vertical farm needs around 3,500 kilowatt hours per year, with 98% of that energy use due to artificial lighting and climate control. Of course, renewable energy sources could be used, but the idea of taking some of the tiny amount of renewable energy which society harvests, some of which we get from the sun via solar panels, and then use it to replicate the sun in an indoor farm, begs the question of why we don't just use the sun in the first place. Proponents of vertical farming will argue that because the food is grown closer to wherever it's consumed, there are fewer food miles between the farm and table, and thus less fuel emissions in greenhouse gases. But reducing the number of miles food travels doesn't actually help the environment all that much, as local food typically requires the same amount of energy per pound to be transported as food from far away. This is because food travelling long distances on ships, trains, and lorries on motorways use less fuel per pound per mile than small trucks driving around cities. And the emissions from food miles pale into insignificance when you compare them to the emissions from deforestation and methane emitted from cows. More local food systems are good for the environment, but only when the farms themselves aren't using up huge amounts of energy to run them. The energy requirements for vertical farming essentially cancel out the benefits of them being local in the first place. Then there are the costs involved. Just one container from Freight Farms costs $104,000 plus shipping. You could get over 10 acres of farmland for the same price in some parts of the US. And the produce is expensive too. The mini lettuce that Green Line Growers sells costs more than double the typical price of organic lettuce sold in shops. For cannabis growers, the cost of running an indoor operation is worth it due to its high market price. Lettuce doesn't quite add up in the same way. The target audience for this kind of farming, both in terms of those doing the farming and those buying from them, is clearly the affluent. Personally, I'm not sure we really need more gourmet lettuce. And speaking of lettuce, that's one of the very few crops that can actually be grown in an indoor vertical farm. The artificial conditions don't allow for the proper mix of heat and light to trigger all plant development stages, for instance, the stage at which a plant produces fruit. Vertical farms have a hard time growing anything beyond lettuce, leafy greens, herbs, and edible flowers. If the technology does improve to the extent that potatoes, tomatoes, and green beans, for example, were able to be grown in these farms, a lot of space would then be taken up by their inedible leaves, roots, and stems. Moreover, vegetables as a whole only occupy 3% of US farmland anyway. In terms of feeding the nation, more leafy greens grown inside isn't really what the vast majority of people are asking for, or indeed need. Salad is not the same as food. We still need all the farms outside the cities growing food in the usual ways. Vertical farms don't reduce any of the bad practices still plaguing the agriculture industry. It's an add-on that also adds more to the burden of emissions. Vertical farming still excites. These issues with vertical farming are not hidden away or covered up as such, and yet the hype around vertical farms continues to propagate. The projections that the vertical farming market will hit $4 billion in 2020 keeps investors investing. The headlines telling us that vertical farming will feed the world keep the rest of us idealistic and hopeful. The point we're missing when we are swept up in the vertical farming hype is that it is simply irrelevant to the lives of those living and working in the rural regions where the vast majority of our food is farmed. And even when we do accept that it's a solution for the wealthy, we're caught up in our sentimental attachment to local food production without considering the broader environmental cost that comes with a vertical farming approach. There are many other innovative local farming systems, such as rooftop aquaponics that use fish excrement to grow in the sun, or green walls that grow crops vertically outside, which use far less energy as they don't require artificial lighting. In the UK city of Manchester, there are 136 hectares worth of flat, unoccupied rooftops. Is our sentimentality and attachment to vertical farming therefore simply trendy? When you consider the entire farming system, vertical farming does nothing to end soil abuse as all the soil farms are still required. It does little to improve malnutrition worldwide, or even within the cities in which the farms reside, due to the high cost of produce. It does nothing to make the lives of the small-scale farmers operating 90% of the world's farms any easier. There's an argument to be made that the investment of over $150 million into vertical farming startups in 2018 could have been put to better use, if the ultimate goal is to improve the system as a whole, as opposed to create high-priced products for the few. Technology alone can't save us. There are many incredible efforts happening in the agritech space that have the potential to have a real effect on farmers and consumers both now and in the future. The excitement in the space is fair, but only to some degree. First, the majority of the investment and attention is focused on solutions that still play into the overarching problems of the agriculture industry. The biggest piece of the total investment into agritech in 2018, $3.9 billion worth, went towards restaurant marketplaces and food delivery companies. The second biggest, $3.6 billion, went to online food stores. Adding them together means that 44% of the total amount of money put towards trying to make change to the global agriculture sector went towards door-to-door food delivery. Second, there's a limit as to how much impact the new innovations can have in solving the biggest food industry problems. The plant-based burgers and the vegan milk products might be able to chip away at some of the problematic agricultural practices in developed countries, but they do little for food insecurity and global malnutrition if not done effectively at scale. Digital solutions that are only affordable or applicable to large industrial farms have only marginal effects in improving the lives and livelihoods of farmers around the globe. When thinking about innovation in science and technology with respect to the food and agriculture industry, you have to consider it in two halves. There are those who are making food better for those who can afford it, and those making food and farming better for those who can't. Much of the hype surrounding agritech uses narratives related to the latter group to sell innovations that sit firmly in the former. Vertical farms and other efforts targeted towards the wealthy simply shouldn't be spoken about in the context of feeding the world or revolutionising agriculture. There's nothing wrong with choosing high-income customers as the target audience, but using save-the-world narratives to sell your vision is not only misleading, it does nothing to change the broader agriculture industry status quo. Not all innovators and entrepreneurs are deliberately using these narratives to hype up their companies and inventions, but there is a severe lack of discussion, acceptance, and vocal challenging of the elephant in the room that affects each and every person operating in the industry, which projects a kind of, we can just invent our way out of this mess, idealism, that is simply unrealistic. That elephant, which incentivises problematic behaviour, puts value on the cheapness of food as opposed to the environmental health and social impact, and creates an ever-expanding difference in wealth between large agribusinesses and small family farms, is the government subsidy. Substandard subsidies. Agricultural subsidies are payments and other kinds of support that a government makes to farmers for producing enough food to feed the nation. The subsidies are meant to protect farmers from unexpected economic disasters. The US program began in the 1930s during the Great Depression, reduce the impact of unpredictable weather on farmer income, and generally support the industry that provides arguably the most important thing citizens need. Subsidies sound good in theory, but the reality is that, in many countries, subsidies do far more harm, and actually are what are keeping the flawed agricultural industry from innovating, shifting to more sustainable practices, and improving the health of society. The US government currently gives out about $25 billion in farm subsidies annually. In Europe, the CAP, Common Agricultural Policy, gives out 50 billion euros per year to the farmers across the continent. Many people believe that subsidies are predominantly there to support small family farms, but in both the US and in Europe, the vast majority of subsidies are funneled into industrial-scale agribusiness and large farms. In Europe, this is mostly due to the fact that subsidies are allocated based on the amount of an owner's land that can be farmed, and that land doesn't even need to be farmed, as the rules only stipulate that the land has to be ready at the owner's disposal. You cannot claim subsidies unless you own or lease at least 5 hectares, meaning small farms are entirely ineligible. And even within the recipient pool, though, there's a massive skew towards giving huge lump sums to the few wealthy farms and, at the other end of the scale, smaller amounts to the many, still quite large, farms. The top 10% of recipients receive nearly half the total subsidy, while the bottom 20% receive only 2%. In the US, it's a similar story, with the top 10% of farm businesses receiving 78% of the subsidy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.